All right. Today we are going to look at the problem of on-chip communication. What does that involve? What are the architectures and techniques that we can use in order to accomplish on-chip communication? What are the things we are trying to communicate and so on? Okay. So over the last couple of classes, we focused a little bit more on specifics related to actually implementing something on the Xilinx hardware. Now what we are going to do is take a step back and look at the overall problem of on-chip communication architectures in a slightly more general sense, right? And we will then be going on to look at certain issues related to actual hardware implementation, optimizations and so on in the context of high-level synthesis. So just to put the context right, the past couple of classes were more required as more of a digression from the normal flow of the course, primarily targeted at the question of how do you get your projects rolling, right? So please make sure that I had sent out a couple of emails yesterday. Please make sure that you go through them and get back with the core topics of your projects as quickly as possible. What we are going to be doing now is covering more general background material, which of course is relevant from the point of view of what you will finally be implementing, but is not going to be very specifically focused on FPGAs or other kinds of implementation. So the first question that we need to answer when we are going into this is, what do we mean when we talk about on-chip communication, right? So the overall picture is, since we are talking about on-chip, it means that there is some notion of a chip within which there are certain kinds of computations going on, right? So I'll call this the chip boundary. And there are, let's say, to start with, two modules, right? Or two processing elements. I'll call them M1 and M2, two modules that need to do some computation. Okay? Obviously, there is going to be some interaction with the outside world. There will be some input, there will be some output. These are off chip. Right, so anything going outside the chip boundary is considered off-chip. It's not a very clearly defined boundary. It's not very clear why you would study the on-chip versus off-chip things separately, except for one specific characteristic. Typically, the moment that you go off-chip, outside a particular chip, it means that you are leaving the silicon wafer, you are going over metal wires, going out over a PCB trace, going into another chip over its bonding pads and so on. The capacitances that are involved over there are typically a few orders of magnitude higher than what you would have inside a single chip. So even though in principle they are all wires that are trying to get electrical signals from A to B, the magnitude of the corresponding capacitances are hugely different in the case of off-chip versus on-chip communication. Which is why very often you will find that the problems of on-chip communication and off-chip communication are studied completely differently, and they have different solutions that are proposed for them also. So now what we are saying, in other words, is we are interested in this problem. How do I communicate between M1 and M2? Okay, so that's the sort of simplest form of on-chip communication that we can think of. Two modules that need to transfer data back and forth between each other. Okay, so at the simplest level, what we could think of is something like this. I have two modules, M1 and M2. If I want to transfer some data from M1 to M2, I need to have a set of signals that are going from M1 to M2. The very bare minimum that I need is some wires that carry the data. But in addition to that, there should be something that also allows me to indicate some form of control, right? Basically to say when I'm transferring data, when is the data valid, when the receiver should actually capture the data properly and so on. Okay, that I'll broadly classify as control. Okay, now there is a third part to this, which is sometimes included under control, but sometimes also considered separately, which is basically the address. If there is only M1 and M2, then there's no real addressing to be done. Either M1 is trying to talk to M2, or no one is trying to talk to M2. Okay? Okay, so there's no separate addressing that you need over here, right? But in more complex situations, that might also be required, separate addressing, in which case either we can club it under the broad category of control or consider it as a separate topic on separate bus of its own. What happens if M2 wants to send data to M1? It can't use the same wires, right? Why? Because wires are unidirectional. They are driven by a gate. Okay, if I connect a gate to a wire, whenever the output of that gate goes high, it means that the voltage on that gate is being pulled up, and whenever the output on the of that gate goes low, it means the voltage on that wire is going to be pulled low, right? I cannot have two gates doing the same thing to the same wire at a given time. So the simplest way to do it would be have another bus in the opposite direction, which is also got its own data and control. Okay, so this is essentially what we end up with, is two point-to-point links, right? A communication link is essentially something that allows data to be transferred from one point to another. In this case, it's a point-to-point link because it starts at the sender, terminates at the receiver, no other branches, nothing else over here. This is the most trivial form of communication that you can think of. Okay. What happens if I have three modules? Now I have M1 over here, M2 over here, and M3. Okay. The simplest way by which I could go forward with this is have a link between M1 to M2, a corresponding reverse link from M2 to M1. Now what happens if M1 wants to talk to M3? Put another link over there. What about M2 to M3? Once again, same story. Right? If I have n modules, how many links will I need? So each one, right, it's essentially going to be the total number of edges in this graph that I'm going to connect, right? So at any point in time, I can choose two of the nodes, and there has to be a link between them. In fact, there have to be two links, one in each direction, right? 2 into n C2. So basically equal to n into n minus 1 is basically order of n squared. Point-to-point links will be required in order to establish full connection between every pair of nodes in the system. Okay? There may be situations where you actually want to have something of the sort. There are obvious problems over here. One is, as I increase the number of modules, the number of wires or links that I require is going up as n square. Okay? Which means not only that I have large number of wires, it also means that routing them is going to become nearly impossible after a while, because I can already see that, you know, once I go to 4, even the routing is going to become difficult in a planar geometry. I'll need to have some way of going over a set of wires. I could probably go around it in this case, but as you go to larger and larger numbers, that routing essentially becomes impossible. You can no longer do it completely in a planar fashion, right? So routing will become difficult, and just the number of wires itself is going to be a problem. Okay, so naturally this leads us to the question of, and on top of that, the question that you can then ask is, I have all of these wires, are they actually being used? Right, I've put in all this hardware. Are they actually being used, or are those wires just there because I need to be able to communicate once per day, maybe between two modules? Right, every time I switch on the system, once in a day, I need to send some initialization information from A to B. That's all. It's never used again after that. But I have to put all those wires in place permanently over there, because if I ever need to do the communication. Right. So the natural way of sort of looking at this is, forget it, this is just too inefficient. How do I share this? Right? So then the moment we are talking about sharing a link, it becomes a question of how do I take a wire, right, and share it between two modules. In other words, I have M1 and M2, both need to be able to change the voltage on a given wire. How do I do this? Okay, because if I, let's say that I have something of this sort, I have a AND gate, I have another OR gate, and I just take both of these and connect them up over here. This can essentially lead to a short circuit. Okay, so it can't be done, right? So the question then becomes, how do I do it? How do I get M1 and M2 to be able to change the voltage on a given wire at the same time? There are a couple of different ways by which I can do this. One method is to say I will use a multiplexer. Okay. So what happens in a multiplexer is, I have a select signal over here, and I have the data coming from M1 and I have the data coming from M2. This has now been selected, right? Either M1 or M2 has been selected based on what the value of that select signal was. The contention has been removed, or the contention has been resolved using the mux and the select. Okay, so what is contention? It just deals with, and it is a word used to signify that there are two pieces of hardware trying to drive the same wire to different voltages at the same time. There could be potentially. Using a mux, that is completely taken care of, because as long as the select signal is either 0 or 1, only one of these values can come through. Okay. Now, what happens with this is, I can also go to n cross 1 muxes, right, which will essentially have log n bits for the select, and I will have M1, M2 up to Mn with one output coming over here. Okay, so this is also perfectly fine, it will work. Another approach that can be used is using so-called tri-state logic, right? So tri-state essentially deals with the fact that the transistors that are used in order to actually implement these logic gates, under certain conditions, they can actually be made to behave like a high impedance terminal, right? Meaning that for all practical purposes, it is just disconnected from the rest of the circuit. Okay, the normal symbol that is used for that would be something like this. Okay, so this is the tri-state control. This is input, this is output, this is essentially a so-called tri-state buffer, right? Implementing this is actually very straightforward in CMOS logic. It's possible to do it without too much difficulty, right? You just need a couple of extra transistors on top of what you would have for a basic CMOS inverter, and you can get an inverting tri-state buffer very easily. Now, keep in mind that as far as I am concerned, as far as the person building the communication system is concerned, an inverter and a buffer are essentially the same thing. If you can tell me ahead of time that, you know, you are going to invert all the signals before you pass them on, then I can take care of that in my logic. Okay. So implementing a tri-state buffer, inverting buffer, non-inverting buffer, all of those are very easy to do. What I can do with those is, I can then say, I'll take the output from M1. Take the output from M2 up to Mn. And what do I do with these wires? I simply short all of them together. And what I do over here is I give separate signals S1, S2, and so on up to SN. Right? Now I need to ensure that at any time only one out of S1 to SN is equal to 1. All the others are disabled.
So is this the communication between M1 to M2 or
M2? No, sorry. So actually that's true. In both of the cases, right, both here as well as in the next case, M1 and M2 are both trying to communicate to someone else. Okay, so this should basically be what I'll call the target. Right? But yeah, M1 is not trying to communicate to M2. They cannot in the present setup. Okay, same story here. This is directly connected to the target. Right? So as long as I ensure that either all the S1 to SN can be off, that's also okay. At least, you know, electrically it's not a problem. Right? Or at most exactly one of them from S1 to SN is equal to 1. That particular signal, whatever that M1 to M1, M2, the output of that particular module will come through to the output and will be seen by the target. Okay, so in other words, both of these multiplexers as well as tri-state logic are two different ways by which I can implement a shared wire. Okay, that's all. At this point, it is just a shared wire. It means that two of them are able to use the same wire in order to communicate with a third party. Okay, or N of them are able to communicate with the target, not between each other. Okay, but the moment I can do sharing of this sort, it should be possible to do it the other way as well. Okay, so this basically tells us that in principle, at least from an electrical point of view, it's possible to have communication from multiple sources to a single destination. From a single source to multiple destinations is actually much easier. You just connect the same wire everywhere, right? And everybody hears it, but only one of those should respond or should do something with it, right? It's like I address somebody in the class, I call their name, everyone else can ignore what I'm saying, right? So as long as there is some way of selecting the target, the one-to-many communication is very easy to do, right? The target just needs to listen properly. Many to one is more tricky because electrically there is a problem. There are actually multiple wires that are coming in and need to be combined together. But now that we know how to do it, let's look at how we would take this further, right? So in this situation, what I would now say is, if I had a situation where multiple modules needed to talk to each other, I could now look at M1, M2 and M3, right? And they all go into one black box which is sitting on the side. Okay, so all of them have two-way communication with this black box. That's all, right? And what it effectively means is that black box can now take care of setting up communications. If I want M1 to talk to M2, or if I want M1 to talk to M3, or M2 to talk to M3, all of those can be done through the black box. Okay, so this part of it becomes a shared bus, okay, which can then set up communications between each of these pairs as required. Okay, so now there is a little bit of terminology that comes up over here that is worth explaining. There's something called a master, and a master on a bus is something that can initiate a transaction on the bus. What is a transaction? We'll get to that later, but effectively initiate communication on the bus, right? It can actually pull the values of the voltages, high or low at some point without waiting for anyone else to give permission. Okay, so this can initiate a transaction on the bus, right? The opposite of that obviously is the so-called slave, which can only respond to a request that's coming from the bus, because the master is not going to talk directly to the slave. The master will send its signals, they will be intercepted by the bus. The bus will then send some signals further down to the slave. But for all practical purposes, it's as good as saying the master is able to communicate with the slave. Okay? Now, once we have these two basic pieces of terminology, we can start thinking of different configurations of what a bus could look like, of what a system could look like, a system that uses this bus, right? And there are two so-called degenerate configurations of this that are worth at least understanding, right? So the two sort of trivial cases: N masters, one slave. Can you think of what this hardware configuration corresponds to? There are N different modules that have the ability to initiate a transaction on the bus, but there is only one slave that whose job is only to respond. No, a MUX, by the way, I mean, see, MUXes and so on are not the kind of modules that we are talking about here. They are just what we would call infrastructure IP. They are used for as building blocks. It's like an adder, right? So a MUX is, for all practical purposes, like an adder. It's not a complex module on its own. So each and every one of these modules, the M1, M2 that I'm drawing over here, is something that has, in almost certainly will require some internal state machine of its own to control its behavior, and most likely does something non-trivial. Okay, the most trivial kind of a module, the slave in some sense, is what we are actually going to use in this example, which is a memory block, right? So one way of looking at this would simply be that I have a memory block and two CPUs. Okay, so both of these would be masters, whereas this one would be a slave. Think about it, the memory by itself is never going to try and transfer data somewhere, right? The whole idea of a memory is it's a storage space. So anytime that somebody wants to either put data in there or get data out of it, they will make a request. Right? The memory by itself is not going to volunteer information. So it's a slave in this case, very clearly defined. If I have two different CPUs, both of them potentially at any point in time might want to read some data from the memory. Therefore, they are both potential bus masters. Okay? The other case is one master, n slaves. This is also fairly easy to understand. I could just think of it as, this is my CPU, this is the master, and on the other side, example peripherals, what can you think of? One is of course the memory itself. Then let's say I have a keyboard, mouse, display, Ethernet card, serial port, USB, printer, right? Any number of things are all on the other side, okay? By default, I can think of all of them as things that are slaves, in the sense that at any point in time, the only one that is actually doing work or is requesting data from all of these is going to be the CPU, okay? Right? So these two cases are actually fairly easy to understand, But they already illustrate two extra things that we need to sort of watch out for, right? The second case, one master, n slaves, is, like I said, the case where, you know, there's one master and all that it needs to do is give out, as long as it mentions who it's trying to talk to. Is it trying to poll the keyboard to find out what key was pressed? Or is it trying to look at the mouse to see where the mouse has moved to? Or is it trying to write some data onto the screen? All of those, the CPU is the master. Okay? All that it needs is that the bus over here requires some kind of decode logic. Right? And what the decode logic means is the CPU is not able to talk directly to the memory or to the keyboard. It only sends some, it has a standard set of connections that connect it to the bus. But the number of wires required for the keyboard peripheral versus the number of wires required for the memory unit are probably different. The bus takes care of filtering that out. It sees what is the CPU trying to do. How does it understand that? By looking at the control signals, part of which is the address bus that is put out, the address. Okay. So, like we discussed in the previous class, memory mapping essentially means that that address can now be used in order to indicate which of the peripherals I am trying to talk to. The bus looks at the address and decodes it. When I say, you know, this is sort of a anthropomorphic way of looking at it. There's nothing on sitting on the bus that's actually looking at it. It's just a set of gates adding things together and deciding, okay, is there a match or not, right? But as long as the bus is able to match the address that was sent, that was put out there by the CPU, and say, okay, this corresponds to the keyboard, right? Either send some control signal to the keyboard or get data back from the keyboard so that it can be sent back to the CPU. Okay? If it was for the display, then basically take whatever is coming from the CPU, send it to the display module, etc. So the bus takes care of decoding. Okay? What happens in the other case when I had two masters and one slave? That's a bit more tricky, because even though logically it's quite simple to draw this, right? And we also figured out that, yes, you know, as long as I have tri-state logic or multiplexers, I can get multiple masters to electrically connect. I still haven't decided which one gets to talk at any given point in time. Okay? What if both the CPUs want to read from memory at the same time? Or one CPU wants to read from memory, can it be sure that the other one is not trying to use the bus at the same time? Can it just go ahead and, you know, start a conversation? Or does it have to wait for something? All that essentially means that there is something called arbitration. That needs to be done by the bus. Okay? So just like there are masters and slaves, the moment you have multiple masters, it means that there is something called arbitration that is required. And the moment you have multiple slaves, it means there is decoding to decide which of those slaves is being spoken to. Okay? So this business of arbitration logic, how do I decide which master gets to communicate at any given point in time, is a non-trivial problem. There are, of course, multiple solutions to it. You can think of simple solutions on your own. Anyway, we'll go over a couple of those later. Right? But moving forward from here, the next thing that we can then think of is, obviously, there was nothing preventing me from having both multiple masters as well as multiple slaves at the same time. Right? If I have m masters and s slaves, I would have S1, S2 up to S subscript capital S, right? I would need arbitration logic on this side and decode logic on this side in order to decide who gets to talk to what. Okay? Now, of course, comes the question, What about the efficiency? What about the throughput? What is the best communication pattern that I can actually use over here? Because one thing, the way that I have drawn this right now, it clearly shows a problem. There are M masters and S slaves. At any given point in time, how many of them can talk to each other? Only one pair. Okay? So, by the way, before we go further, one thing I just want to say. Can you think of any peripheral that could be both a master and a slave?
ADC.
Huh?
ADC.
Why would you say an ADC is a master as well as a slave? An ADC is almost certainly a pure slave in the sense that it's just the whenever the CPU wants, it gets data from the ADC. Huh? Even SPI is actually a bus by itself. So an SPI is not in itself a peripheral. An SPI is an interface. Okay? So in fact, the buses that we are drawing over here, SPI could be used in order to implement the interface part of it. But by itself, it is not a module. DMA, on the other hand, right? So what is DMA? It's direct memory access. We will look at that a little bit more, especially in the context of actually implementing the hardware later. Direct memory access is specifically introduced in order to do one thing, which basically says there can be situations where I just want to copy a large amount of data from somewhere to somewhere else, from some bunch of memory locations to another bunch of memory locations. It's possible that both of those blocks of memory are in the actual RAM itself, or one block could be in the RAM and the other one could correspond, let's say, to the Ethernet device, right? Or it could correspond to the video display, right? In such a situation, essentially what I have is that DMA module has to behave in two ways. One is, it has to be able to get instructions from the CPU. So it becomes a slave, right? That is when a CPU decides that it wants to talk to this particular, that it wants to set up a DMA transfer, it has to be able to talk to the DMA module. On the other hand, once the CPU has given the instructions, the DMA then needs to take over the bus and actually say, I want to transfer data from A to B without the CPU getting involved. Okay? So it's possible to have one device which is both master as well as slave, right? But in this case, what we are going to assume is that I will just logically split it into two parts. Put the slave interface on the right side, master interface on the left side, and treat them as two separate interfaces, even though they belong to the same hardware module. Right? As long as I just make that logical separation between them, there is no conflict. I can treat the same module both as a master and as a slave. Okay? Now, with that out of the way, what we can say is, if I have multiple masters and multiple slaves, with a shared bus like this, at any given point in time, only one pair can talk. And this is bad news, especially as the number of masters and number of slaves goes up. Okay? So what can you do about it? What would you, can you propose any way by which this could be solved? One possibility is multiple buses. Okay? So let's, in fact, now I'm no longer even going to draw masters and slaves separately. I'll just draw them as modules, right? And assume that any one of them could be either a master or a slave. It doesn't really matter. Okay? So what I'm saying is, I have this simple system over here which has M1, M2, M3. Okay? What if I also put another bus out here and just connect all three to that also? Okay? This is probably a bad example because there are after all only three devices. So let me just add one more over here. Okay. Now what I could have is, I can think of a situation where, let's say, M1 is talking to M2 and at the same time M3 is talking to M4. Both communications can go on at the same time because they are happening on different buses. Okay? it still is not a trivial solution, because now M3, when it wants to communicate with M4, first has to look, it'll probably look at the same bus that M1 is already using. Then decide, I can't use this because it's busy. Let me go look at the other bus. Okay, that's free. Now let's use that. It complicates your internal logic a little bit, but not as much as you would think. Because after all, you know, this whole business of I will go look over here, then do this. It's not like somebody is running around doing this. There are electrical signals that automatically just flag, okay, this is not available. The next one goes high and activates that the other bus can be used. Okay. But it does obviously complicate your internal logic. It's possible to do at the expense of internal logic. You could also have another situation where, for example, M1 talks to M4 and M2 talks to M3. That's also possible, right? So multiple different combinations of this sort can happen at the same time, right? It still doesn't address the question of whether M1 can talk to M2 and M3 at the same time. That may or may not be possible. That's now more a question of how M1 is implemented. Okay, so multiple buses, in other words, is one way of doing it, right? Another thing that can be done is actually to say, let me be a bit more clever about this. Can I think of splitting a bus? Okay, so what does that mean? A split bus is actually a bit more tricky. What it's basically saying is, I have M1 over here, M2 over here, M3 and M4. I have a bus. But now what I'm going to do is break this and have some kind of a bridging module in the that goes between them. Okay. What does this bridge do? Effectively, what it accomplishes is that I can now communicate between M1 and M2 and M3 and M4 at the same time. But if I wanted to do, let's say, M2 to M3, at that point, this is not going to work. Right? So the question becomes, how do I do M2 to M3 in the first place? The bridge has to get activated. I need to indicate that I need to make a communication across the bridge. There will be some logic in that bridge that basically says, okay, now I need to connect the two sides together and allow the signals that are coming from, let's say, whichever is the master, to go across the bridge to the other side, get decoded over there and communicate to the other side. Right? So the result of this was that if I was just talking between M1 and M2 and M3 and M4 respectively, then they can go on completely in parallel, right? But the moment that I want to go across that bridge, that becomes the bottleneck, right? And unless I'm able to sort of, and in that case, effectively what it means is that I'm back to my single shared bus kind of topology. I could combine this. I could have split as well as multiple buses, right? Obviously, this starts to get even more and more complicated, right? Another place where this is sometimes done is not just in something called a split bus. You also have something called a hierarchical bus. Right? Where again, the story is somewhat similar. You have M1 over here talking over a bus to, let's say, memory. And you have a bunch of other peripherals over here that, you know, are basically like the keyboard and serial port, right? But over here, I have some other things which are essentially, let's say, Ethernet and display. So can you see what's common to the stuff that's on the left versus on the right? So this M1 is basically the CPU, let's say. So the CPU, memory, Ethernet, display, all on the left hand side, keyboard, serial port on the right hand side. And there's a bridge in between them. what do you think separates the two sides? I mean, why would I make them two separate sides?
Speed.
Speed, right? Typically, at what speed is a keyboard responding? It depends on how fast you are able to press buttons, right? How fast do you type? Pretty much the fastest that you can do is probably 100 key presses per minute. Okay, that's almost the mechanical limit of the speed at which you can type. Okay, so if that's the case, 100 key presses per minute is nothing. I mean, that's like barely, you know, less than 2 keystrokes per second. Okay, even if I just keep a key pressed, it's probably only a few key, it translates into a few key presses per second, not thousands, maybe 10 or 20, somewhere around that. Okay, which means that the rate at which data is coming from the keyboard is on the milliseconds time scale, right? It's like a few tens per second maximum. Serial port, maybe a bit more than that, you might go up to kilobits per second, but that's about it. Ethernet, on the other hand, you might be actually talking about data transfers in the gigabit per second range. Main memory, of course, the CPU wants to talk to memory as fast as it can. And the display unit also requires a large amount of data because you are trying to refresh that screen 30 or 60 times per second. Okay, so everything on the left has a huge amount of data that, and any time that it gets activated, the data needs to get transferred at a very high speed. Okay, whereas the ones on the right are going to be very slow. What's the problem there? The biggest problem is, let's say that the CPU tries to read something pressed on the keyboard. It issues a request to the keyboard, response comes back 10 milliseconds later. For that 10 milliseconds, what's the CPU going to do? It can't just sit idle. It could have done a few million instructions within that time. Okay? So those kind of things, you want to separate them out. You might even have a situation where I just run this at a slower clock. And this is the high performance. Say, right? And you could take this further. You could basically have the splitting of the buses taken to multiple levels, where I first have a split and then further split it into other peripherals, unless there is at least one master on each of those splits. It doesn't allow you to increase the bandwidth of the bus, but in a case like this, it might not really be about increasing the bandwidth. It might just be about separating it out and preventing the bus from being locked up by somebody. Okay, so all of these, in other words, are different architectures, different structures that can be used in order to implement the basic topology of a bus. Okay, then comes the question, what are you going to do with it? Okay, and that essentially leads to this concept that of what's called transactions. Okay, so a bus transaction essentially deals with multiple stages. Okay, and especially when we are having a situation where there is something like a CPU, a master, or multiple CPUs, multiple masters talking to a bus and they want to get data from the other side, it goes through a set of phases, signaling phases. Okay, the typical flow is something like this. There is something called a request that comes from a master. The bus will then issue a grant signal, and then after that, the master will actually transfer the additional control signals, possibly the address. Finally, there will be transfer of data. Okay, all of this together would typically become one transaction. So in other words, if the CPU wanted to read some data that is sitting in the memory, the actual process that goes through is, it first has to request access to the bus. The bus arbiter will, this will be done by the bus arbiter, right, which takes care of bus arbitration. The arbiter would say, okay, fine, now you can talk. Then the CPU puts out the memory address from which it wants to read. And finally, the slave, which is the memory controller in this case, actually gets the data back and returns it. Okay, so all of these together form one transaction, right? And if you typically look at it, the timeline of a transaction could be something of this sort. Usually these are represented using some kind of timing diagrams, right? So the most important one is basically the clock. Along with that, of course, any bus will also have some kind of a reset signal associated with it, which is implicit. I'm just assuming that, you know, all digital logic has a reset, so I'm not mentioning that separately. But the process would go something like this. There would be a request signal which would go high. Right. And assuming that the clock is triggered on, rather all the elements are working on the positive edge of the clock, it means that if the request signal goes high somewhere here, it will be seen at the next positive edge of the clock by the bus. Okay. When would the grant signal come back? If, assuming that the bus is free, a grant signal would then go up here immediately after that. Okay, and then this could take care of putting the address. Depending on how it interprets the grant signal, either it has to wait until the next clock cycle so that it actually sees that the grant signal has been given to it. Okay, or it might do some kind of combinational logic and say that the moment the grant signal is high, the address is also made high. So it essentially has a dependency from here to here. Then all this is from the master, right? It has gone to the bus. Let's say that the slave was a memory controller. This address then gets passed on to the memory controller. It has to retrieve the data and finally come back. In the ideal situation, in the very next clock cycle, the data will come back. But it is possible that the data which is being read back actually comes several cycles later. Okay, and let's say comes somewhere out here. Right, so this is essentially the complete sort of flow of signals that would happen for one transaction to take place. This is an example of one read transaction from a module like a memory block, right? So the master would put out a request, one cycle later it would get a grant, then it would put out an address, a few cycles later it would get back the data. Okay, this part that you see over here essentially is handshaking overhead. Or arbitration overhead. Okay, why are we calling it overhead? Because in the ideal situation, if it was only one master and one slave, I could have just been reading on every clock cycle. But now, even before I can issue one read, I first need to get access to the bus, right? This is the simplest form of a transaction. I put out a request, I get the grant, I put out the address, wait for some time, get back the result. If every transaction was like this, you can imagine that it would be horribly inefficient, right? Because for every value that I want to read from memory, first I have to send out a request, wait for a grant, and then read one value. So that's three cycles gone anyway. If the memory takes a long time to return with the value, that's so many more cycles also gone. Okay? So in the simplest form that I can implement a bus like this, it's going to be terribly inefficient. Obviously, there are ways around it. Even from the way I described it, we can think of ways around this. One of them is to use a so-called burst mode of transaction, right? So burst transactions will essentially say request, grant, address, and multiple data. So the number of data would be specified in the control signaling, right? So for example, what I can do is I can say I want to burst read 4 values from memory. Okay, there would be one request, one grant, one address, but 4 values will be returned from memory. Okay, so I am able to take the fact that I had this overhead of request, grant, and putting out the address and split it out over 4 accesses. Right, I could go further, maybe make it 8 accesses, maybe make it 16. I could keep increasing that number. The point is, after a while it becomes counterproductive, because I'm not always trying to read bursts of data, right? So I don't want to unnecessarily provide for very huge bursts. I would much rather have some reasonable size bursts, let's say up to 16 values or something of that sort, and then if necessary, you know, take that additional overhead of again request, grant after that. The other problem with, so the problem with having a burst is that during that time, that's the only one, only activity that is happening. So if I ask for a very long burst, let's say I ask for a 1 kilobyte burst, right? For the next 1,000 cycles, the bus is occupied just transferring that data. Nobody else can talk. Whereas if I limit the size of my burst and say this is at most going to be up to so many clock cycles, so 16 cycles or so, right? Then I still have reduced the overhead of my request, grant, and address signaling and spread it out over 16 data transfers, right? So burst transactions are sort of the most obvious but important improvements that are made on the bus, right? There are a few more that we will consider next, basically something including splitting transactions and pipelining them, right? Which again are fairly obvious, but it's worth sort of understanding how they get implemented in a little bit detail, right? So that's it. We'll stop here for now. We'll continue on Wednesday and look at further details on how the buses get implemented. And moving further from there will be, how do you generalize the idea of on-chip communication beyond that of a bus?